there's a man going round taking names, and he decides who to free and who to blame. Everybody won't be treated all the same. There'll be a golden ladder reaching down when the man comes around.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Bridging the Gap. Today is Monday, August 15th, and I do have a special guest today. Gill Broussard is going to join us today. Last week, his computer and stuff just would not cooperate, and so he came on this week. I'm so thankful for that. And actually, this ends up to be a little bit of an answer to prayer. A few weeks ago, I did a show on the red dragon and the red horse, and I was praying about that. And a friend of mine sent me this video clip of a guy by the name of Gill Broussard, and wow, I was really surprised. I wasn't even going to watch this, Gill, but you know what? It was about 7X, and no, I don't want to watch another Planet show. But I watched it out of respect to her, Gill, and it was amazing to me, the information that you presented in that video. And I know you're an amateur astronomer, and obviously you're quite skilled at studying the scriptures. You've been in the oil and gas industry for quite a few years. Is there anything else you need to add to that? I mean, it's quite a bio.
Oh, no, thank you, John, for having me, and it's a pleasure. And this planet is definitely a real object. It's a real threat. At first, I was a hardened skeptic, and it's quite easy to be a skeptic with all the false information that doesn't make any scientific or astronomy sense. It's just for clicks, you know, clicks and advertisements on the internet. Well, I'm not about
right.
that.
Right, right.
If it be so. False, I would tell the public clearly it is. If it's factual, I'm going to tell you that also. And this is a real object, and it's heading our way. Has had multiple encounters with our system, with our solar system. And this next time, the Bible gives us a qualifier that it's the worst time in all of Earth's history. I would definitely be paying attention to that quote. According to looking at the models and everything, it lines up with a lot of things, exactly what it's saying. Mm-hmm. on this fiery red dragon, as it's called in the text.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, let's open up with a word of prayer quick, and then we're going to get into some questions and slideshow. So, dear Heavenly Father, we do come before you. We thank you for who you are. And Father, we know that you are in control, you are sovereign, and that the events that are coming are prophesied. And so, Father, as time gets short, I pray that even though we're at the last hour in the vineyard, that some might hear and come and join and be servants of you. And so I pray that the words that Gill and I share today are accurate and bring glory and honor to you. We don't want to mislead anyone. It's in Yahushua's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. So, Gill, you know, let's just cut right to the nitty-gritty of this thing. Time seems to be getting short here. You know, what's this planet 7X or this comet, or, you know, is this a real thing? Is it something that's real that's coming our way?
Yes, it is. It's a planet-sized comet is the best description I can give. You're not looking at some blurry blob anymore. Whenever it's going to show up, it'll look like a comet, mm-hmm. whether it's white or reddish tint. Time will tell, but it definitely has iron mixed in with it because of the magnetic pull and the other missing descriptions that the Bible and other outside texts talks about. It's a metallic object because it passed through Ceres, the planet Ceres. And now Ceres is a, we see debris field, which is called the asteroid belt. And this thing survived. When it went through it, it had a head-on collision with that planet.
Wow.
Circled the sun. It took four trips for it to get to its normal orbit. And it didn't lose any mass because it still had about a little bit over 360-year orbit. So that tells me, straight off the bat, that this has to be a metallic object. And otherwise, it should have shattered, and there should have been only pieces of it that would have lost mass. And that's not what we're seeing in the data from the past events.
Right. So here's the first question coming out of the chat, Gil. Has anyone ever taken a picture of Planet X?
I'm sure they have. The government, with the Pioneer and Voyager probes, we had the infrared telescope in space. That was the first one. That was during the time of Reagan. Shortly after that, Reagan had meetings with a California astronomer, which was friends of his. And they had secret meetings at a hotel, happened to speak to the guard that guarded the astronomer, had called me and told me about this. And shortly after that, this is when the Star Wars was put into play. And you can go listen to a speech at the UN. This is not about when he talks about there's an alien threat. He's not talking about little green men. Mm-hmm. He's talking about a inbound planet, which is also alien to our solar system. And if you listen to him carefully, you can pick it up that this is what he's talking about. He's saying that the Star Wars is not a threat to anybody, that we need to work together to maintain the economy and everything else, and put our differences aside because this is going to be large. So it started with that time period. In 19, they then launched the Pioneer and Voyager probes. It took quite a long time for it to reach the proper position. In 1992, December, is when they had confirmation of its orbit being a very narrow elliptical orbital path like a comet. Remember, they were very public with Planet X. You can go look it up in the magazines. Just don't believe what the Washington Post is telling you. At the time. that was part of the CIA arm at the time, and they were trying to miss. They were trying to misdirect you towards, Orion. So that's about 120 degrees in the opposite direction. You need to look at. You need to look at Sagittarius. That's where south of the universe is. That was one of the key points when I was looking at videos when they were trying to talk about Dr. Harrington, scientific paper. They were saying that that his data was pointing south of the universe. And you can go look at the first videos of all of these people on the internet until I started correcting them. They were pointing everybody to the south pole to look. Well, that's not south of the universe. That is called Nadar, and zenith is the north, and your north, south, east, and west is flat out, in every direction. Yes, on Earth's planetary plane. So south is towards Sagittarius, points right in the middle of the Milky Way, and this is where this item is coming from. This is where we have the data from the Asian astronomers, the Chinese, Japanese, and the Korean astronomers of 1054. And with this data, we were able to plot its orbital path. That's like the tracks of a train. The tracks don't change throughout time. The train may come in late or early, depending on what it bumps into or whatever, or collides with, because this is not on a stable orbit. It's on the same orbit, but it's not a stable orbit. And so right now, if you took the Carrington event. That was an 58 or 59. I can't quite remember. The Carrington event is when the sun had one of the largest CMEs that hit Earth. Mm-hmm. And it burned the insulation off the telegraph wires. Some of the wood ties of a train would catch on fire because the electrical current passing through the rails would heat up enough to where it just ignited them.
Mm-hmm.
Different other things. You can look it up. It was extreme, extreme. Luckily, it was not a electronic age as it is today.
Right.
We'd have that same thing. We'd be back to the Stone Age.
Right.
So you can use that was caused when Planet X reached its outer orbit, its most the longest point, and the sun magnetic field is pulling it back. Therefore, it's it's straining the sun because it's an electrical universe.
Mm-hmm.
And that caused this very large CME. So that's our midway point. So if you double that distance on time, that would have brought the midway point was April of this year. That's already passed.
Mm-hmm.
So the next few years closest to that date is the most likely time frame. So we're in the critical stage here. If it was just before that date or just after that date, that's where it's most likely to misreturn.
So, and of course, the government has quit sharing any information since what, 1992 or something to that effect? About
1992, December is when they went silent. It changed modes. It was no longer kept in NASA's hands. It probably went dark in the military program. The following year, in April, the Vatican opened their its observatory in Arizona, and the infrared instrument that was placed on their telescope was called the Lucifer device.
Mm-hmm.
It was made by our government. Mm-hmm. It has the technology of like our satellites are able to take digital pictures, but the pixels are so small that gives you the resolution of better read a date on a quarter already. Mm-hmm. Where they're using that type of resolution but in an infrared spectrum, so the specs for that Lucifer device is way more than what you're reading about. It's built by our government. Mm-hmm. And that went to a so-called a private institution. So yes, they have pictures, the government,
right.
But it's not shared to the public. As far as I can tell, there's nothing valid that I can substantiate in the public realm at
right.
this time.
Right.
The vast majority of these items are either lens flares, sun dogs. Yes, sun dogs are real because mm-hmm. you can see them, but it's only like a mirage. It's not tangible.
Right.
So there's about 14 different types of mirages you can see in the sky. 14 individual different types. Mm. So just be aware of those. And then there's a photography. You got lens flares. You got people shooting a camera behind a window. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the sensor will bounce off of the window, giving you red, green, and blue orbs in the shot, which has nothing to do with this. And then there's if you have a shiny part of a lens or camera that just reflects back onto the, you know, because you're taking shots of the sun, and your camera is not really designed for that unless you have filters.
Mm-hmm.
So any type of little glitch, it's going to show up on this. And people don't like those answers right there. But there is nothing valid at the moment that's in the public eye.
Right.
Whenever we see it, you know it. and it's going to look like a comet, not an orb, like what people are showing you. So that's the best.
So then this is, but it is a real threat, right? I mean, this is a real threat that's coming towards us. And if so, then for who is this threat? I mean,
this is for the entire world. The world is coming under judgment by God.
Mm-hmm.
There will be one half of the earth that hits harder than the other side, but the other side is not without destruction. It's just minimum, you know, it's lesser than the side that gets hit with the meteor shower.
Right.
But it is devastating globally. The half of the earth that is talked about, it's clear. It says one third the grass, one third the trees, one third of the rivers. Rivers are fresh water. That's mm-hmm. not oceans. So what half of the globe, whenever you're looking at it, is one third of the continental crust. That's North and South America.
Wow.
And you can read that in prophecy. North and South America is no longer listed after that event, after the second event, which is 150 days later. We're no longer mentioned. So it says that they wish death for 150 days before death comes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's pretty complete.
Right.
You don't want to be on this half of the globe whenever this is occurring.
Right. Wow. I mean, and of course, I think it says in Isaiah, if I remember right, Isaiah 13, it talks about how he will make man as scarce as gold, you know, as those gold nuggets. Wow.
Yeah, it's a rare gold. Yes. And also he said if he didn't come back, there'd be no life left.
Right. Yeah. If he doesn't shorten those days. Yeah.
Remember, a lot of this stuff, he's not doing. He has the ability to better control it if he wanted to take it away or anything and stop it.
Mm-hmm.
But because man is stepping away from God, he's allowing these things to happen as he predicted it, because he can see into the future. And that's what he's given us. The book of Revelation is a vision of the future here if we don't change.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like Jonah's warning to Nineveh. They were on a head-on collision with a meteor shower, but they misrepented, and God changed the where there was a gap in the meteors or whatever he had. You know, he's able to tell whether or not they're going to repent or not. They have the free will not to or but just consequences.
Mm-hmm.
And this earth is fixing to go through some major consequences that. Hollywood doesn't even come close to presenting it.
Oh, absolutely. You know, in Genesis 2:1, it says the heavens and the earth were finished and all the host of them. And when you dig into what the word host means in the Strong's concordance here, it says a mass of persons, especially regularly organized for war, by implication a campaign, a battle company of hosts, service soldiers, and waiting upon war. And so, you know, when we stop and think about this comet or whatever it is, and he created all the hosts of heaven, this is one of his implements that he uses then, correct?
Yes, the ancient term, remember, the book was written over 2,000 years ago. They're using ancient terms. They don't have modern terms that are, I mean, like comet, it was only created probably 250 years ago or so. The word for comet back then in Asia was fiery dragon of old, or fiery dragon. The term in Europe for a comet was fiery sword. Not all cases of fiery sword is the comet. You have to read the details, okay, to pick it up. So, but every comet pertaining to fiery dragon is our comet. And so you're dealing with ancient books with ancient terms that are still in the English today. So be aware of what they mean. Like beast is at that time meant like a marching army.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. it can also mean an animal, but in context with what is what's around it tells you if it's talking about a marching army or not.
Right.
So, yeah, this is clearly part of prophecy that's coming to, remember he said he will reveal things in the end days.
Right.
All you have to do is I furnish the graphics as far as for you to have a visual. You read the story and look for the 7-year droughts or 10-year, like in Ruth. You look for either 3 hours or 3 days of darkness, like the Exodus was three days. Yeshua's when he was on the cross was 3 hours of darkness. This happened multiple times especially when you can see that there's a double eclipse. When the Bible talks about the sun going dark and the moon is blood red, that's a double eclipse. Mm-hmm. Double eclipse can't happen in the natural. It takes a third body. And that is mentioned multiple times in the text throughout the Bible. This has happened more than once. But not every time this planet comes around Earth is it a close call. It has different distances that it will pass from Earth.
So it would depend on where Earth is in its rotation versus when that planet comes through. Correct.
At least 2 to 3 times Earth is tilted 26 to 28 degrees. We're going to go through a tilt again. The big part is when we're in the tail of the comet, which is 3.5 days prior to its arrival. This is when they're going to shut down all generators globally. Okay, because it's the same thing as the EMP, the plasma tail of a comet, which has ice also mixed in it, but it's mostly plasma. When it's directed at Earth, this is going to slow down Earth's forward speed and in our rotation. We will end up by the third day, we will lose 12 hours of rotation of Earth. And that would change the target zone from the Middle East to North and South America.
So when does that happen in the approach of this comet then? When does the wind stop, the four winds it says stops, right? And so when does that happen in the approach of this comet?
That's within the last 24 to 48 hours. Because that last day, there's one of the prophecies, I can't remember the prophet that said it, but he said he will make, in the end days, he will make a day into night, night into day. Well, that is not an eclipse. Eclipse cannot give you light at nighttime. This is a 12-hour delay in Earth's rotation. This happened in Joshua's long day. Each story, each major story in the Bible is data points that you can pull that help you define what's going on in the last book. Man can't write that. They were like 300 and something years apart, and there's a underlying model that scientifically is correct, the way that they describe it in sequence. And this is why this the book of Revelation can actually be taken seriously if you understand the ancient terms. The sequence of events are right on point. Remember, it passed 5 other times since Yeshua sacrificed. And the Bible doesn't talk anything about it because it wasn't the major event. It was significant for the weather and the food patterns, you know, and everything, just like we're seeing. But it wasn't catastrophic like it was in certain other events. Not until today when in this electronic age and our highways and bridges and planes and ships and everything. And it's going to be devastating. And then there's a second event, 150 days later, you know, another meteor shower, a second. We're running into the debris that it left behind whenever it was going around the sun. So we have two events, 150 days, we have two meteor showers, And this is the second one. Within that meteor shower is one particular large one. It's called Wormwood. It's the size of a mountain, literally. So within that meteor shower, which that meteor shower is only a half hour, the Bible talks about. The first meteor shower is within 1 hour. But Earth is slowed down in its forward speed. Okay, the second one, we're going at our normal speed, and it's a half hour long. So that meteor shower, I mean, the debris field is much larger, because we're traveling at about roughly 8.4 Earth diameters in an hour. So you take half of that, because it's a half half hour long. So that's 2.25 diameters of Earth wide there. The first one, we're moving at probably around 1/20th of our normal speed forward. That's going to save us, because it's impossible for us to have a head-on collision on the in March or April, because the physics won't allow it. The tail, the closer you get, the deeper in the tail and closer you get to this comet, the higher the pressure is on the braking power of stopping Earth on its rotation and its forward speed. So it's impossible for a collision. But if you do, if you didn't know the physics involved, and astronomers are misrejecting the physics, the physicists are more correct on the universe model than the astronomers are. And this is a key factor. That's why they'll think that we're going into the danger zone when we go to Israel, when actually they're in, they're staying. Remember where, when they go in the ground, it says that becomes their tomb. Because they're on the wrong side of Earth. And these are the globalists and other things. People that don't follow his feast. That's why he, remember, these are Yahovah's feasts, not feast of the Jews, not feast of the Hebrews. There's Yahovah's feast. And he says you'll follow these forever. Not 2,000 years, not forever. And the word feast is a misinterpretation. Really what it is a rehearsal pattern. And what this does, because the Father can see into the future, and if you trust him and what he's given you, he puts you in the right place at the right time. Without his guidance, you wouldn't know this.
Right, exactly. Without
the book of Revelation, which he wrote, he helped write for us, you know, he gave the vision to Yeshua. Yeshua gave it to John. Without that, you won't know where the safe place would be.
Yeah, you're right. Well, Hosea 4:6 says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected the knowledge, I will also reject you, that you shall be no priest to me, seeing you have forgotten the Torah of your Elohim. I will also forget your children." So we can easily, we can say, people perish for lack of knowledge. But why? Because we've rejected his truth. We take Leviticus 23 and throw it out the window and say, that's not for us, right? And you're right. That's where he says, these are his feasts.
Yeshua is the living Torah. He lives by these. There are two laws mentioned in the New Testament. People miss this because it's purposely not stated as a law, but if you can still catch it, it's talking about the laws and the tradition of the Pharisees at the time, or religious leaders. That's across the board in all of the religions today. It's not just the Pharisees today. All of them. They got their own festivals, their own ways of changing the laws. So this is these are Yeshua's house rules. If you want to live in his kingdom,
great way to put it. So I know you touched on a little bit of this, but it does fulfill prophecy, but has, and it's done it in the past, as you mentioned, Joshua's last day. But is this something that we can go back and say, well, this planet caused those events?
God can, or Yahovah can use anything he wishes, because he made everything. It's not outside his power to use a planet or a comet. Why so many people want to put him in a box and say, well, he's not, You need to go just look at the Exodus. It said he used the wind and the water. He separated the waters with the wind. Okay. Yeah. It happened to be when Earth was tilting by this planet. Okay. But the Father knows what the consequences of his action, because he does it to the exact minute and the hour. Right. Remember, Yeshua comes mid of night, right?
Mm-hmm.
Of the night that this planet arrives, after a 12-hour, not midnight, he's coming. Don't mix that up. He's coming mid of that night. That night would be 12 hours longer. Okay. As it was when he was resurrected from the grave. We have artifacts that prove that from the time that he was put on a cross, at the time he got out of the grave, it was actually 3.5 days our time of counting, the way that we count hours.
Right.
In Hebrew counting, it's still 3 days.
Right.
Because they count from sunset to sunset. It doesn't matter how long the day is or night is. It's from sunset to sunset.
Yep.
And we have outside text in the Jewish realm that says it was a double Sabbath. And they can't figure out why today, why it says it was a double Sabbath. Well, that's that Saturday was a double Sabbath. And we have an artifact to prove that. So the eclipse, which was 3 days earlier, which was 3 hours, some of your viewers may not be aware of this, but the moon is what blocks the sun. And it can only give you 7.3 minutes maximum. But this is Passover. the moon's on the wrong side of Earth to be involved with the sun.
Yeah, yeah.
And we have outside text that the moon, the sun was darkened and the moon was blood red. That's a double eclipse. Okay, so how do you get 3 hours of darkness? Had to have a third body that's larger than the moon to give you 3 hours of darkness. And this is multiple times in the biblical text. You just have to go look for it. It's there. All of the, if you look at the Bible with astronomy eyes, look, it just pops out at you, because there's certain anomalies that a normal circumstance doesn't explain. It takes a third body.
Right.
And remember when Joshua was on the daytime at the time of that event, because he told Joshua to go fight the enemy, you know, and everything.
Right.
And he was outnumbered 10 to 1. And the moon was guarding him. The back side of the moon has 4 times more media hits than the front side. It has guarded Earth more than once. As far as Jerusalem and the time that he needs it, or whoever the people that he wanted to guard. So it shielded only for Joshua. The enemy got hit exactly the way Yahweh told him. And it killed more of the enemy than he did with a sword.
Right.
Are we going to remember, Joshua's following Yahweh's instructions. Our instructions today is not the same as Joshua's.
Right.
He said, follow the feast.
Right.
That's why you're in Jerusalem for Sukkot. This is why you're going to be in Jerusalem for Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. This will arrive 3.5 days after the Feast of Unleavened Bread, counting the way we count today.
Right.
So you don't even have to argue about the calendars. There's about 12 different ways people are looking at calendars that they come up with. When they give the 40-day warning or something similar to a 40-day warning, you take that day that they said is going to arrive, count 3.5 days back from that. That would be the Feast of Unleavened Bread. That's when the two witnesses show up. You're going to have confirmation. The two witnesses show up. Well, not you're right on your counting. So you have a double confirmation. So don't, you know, if you're in love with your calendar and it doesn't line up, it's your own fault, you know. So that's what we lean on. It's what he's going to literally show us is the way it's going to be. It's going to follow his timeline. So I hope I cleared that up for some people. It's a, it's a touchy subject. It's a very touchy subject, calendar.
It is. And you're right. If you start to bring up the calendar, I mean, to quote someone else, you know, Dr. Pigeonoy says, you mention the calendar and a hockey game breaks out, because that just seems to be what it is. Everyone's trying to figure out, you know, I've got this right and you're wrong, you know, instead of just trying to follow the path that he has set before us. So when you're talking about that comet or whatever it is, as it goes through, then we have wormwood that comes on the backside and hits it. You're suggesting that that will push the Earth then back closer to the sun and give us this proper 364-day calendar that Enoch speaks about then.
Correct. Remember, Enoch was even before Noah's flood. So here's prophecy all the way from the beginning, all the way to the end being fulfilled, that someone knows the timing to the hour and to the day. Okay. This is proof. So 150 days after the first meteor shower, Earth is hit. Earth runs into the debris field that is left, missing behind. And wormwood hits us on the nighttime side. The first event is in the daytime side. Second one, because of the direction of flow of the debris field, Earth is hit on the nighttime side. This is going to be North and South America a second time, but wormwood would hit more to the west because it's as we're leaving the debris field. And I struggled with the model trying to meet the parameters that the Bible was saying that every wall on Earth is going to be cracked in. When I looked at the impact software and putting in certain size, mountain size asteroids hitting or comet fragments hitting Earth, if you get too large, it would wipe out all life on Earth. So I got to a point where it was like only half the Earth being wiped out. From the heat that is generated from it. One is the all carbon molecules that are within a given distance of it will violently vibrate and they will spontaneous combust into flames. Animals, plants, humans, wood structures, anything. So but that wasn't strong enough to crack every wall, shatter walls and crack globally all the walls. Until I looked at the model carefully, because I was looking at it as like it was a head-on collision, like it was for Ceres. But this is not the way it's going to happen. It's going to happen all the way to the left. If you're looking at Earth in the nighttime, it'll happen all the way to the left, giving it leverage off of center. Okay. Earth is rotating counter the hit.
Okay.
So what this does, it hits us at such a great speed and impact, it hits somewhere around Hawaii, basically. Water does not compress. So what this does is it causes, it's like trying to slam on the brakes. You're skidding, but the core is skidding, but the Earth's mantle is trying to stop. So you have this land wave that moves across all the way around the Earth. And then when the two frequencies kind of get together, part of it is canceling out, which is around the midway point would be around Jerusalem, where it has only buildings are cracked, but every place else they're shattered. You're looking at buildings globally being you're talking about roads being shattered, you're talking about land waves, you're talking about mountains disappearing, some new ones being formed, everything shattered, like almost like you look at glass being shattered. These land waves are huge and very, very destructive. Mm-hmm. Therefore, it fulfills the prophecy again, exactly what it's saying. In the right situation, every wall on earth will be either crumbled or cracked, one of the two, according to the prophet. This is the Bible says this is the most difficult time in all of Earth's history. Noah's flood is not the worst. This next event is. I can't express to the public to get a grip on that. This is not Hollywood. This is Hollywood on steroids times 10, you know, every disaster movie you can think of. Mm-hmm. Added to one scenario. It's that bad.
Right.
Don't think underground places on this half of the globe is your tomb.
So yeah, that's one of the other questions that's kind of come up. Is there or are there any safe places on North and South America? Or is that Revelation 18 come out of her, my people? Is that a literal event that we need to come out so that we don't participate in any of her plagues? But it's more than just that. It's in order for us to survive, we need to be gone from here.
It's everything, yes, because remember, scariest word in the Bible to me is remnant.
Oh, yeah.
And that remnant is, the call is, come out of her, my people.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, the Bible states multiple Babylons.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, if I was in the same order that is given, I would assume that New York City is the first one. It is basically destroyed. It mm-hmm. moves to Europe. It's conquered by the Antichrist or the false Messiah. Okay. Then it moves to Baghdad, Iraq. That's the third Babylon. Finally, where it ends up being is Jerusalem.
Mm.
Because the northern three quarters of Israel is conquered by the Antichrist. Remember, there's another remnant, which is not the same remnant that I was talking about earlier. From the surviving of this conquering, they're pushed to the Negev, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Almost parallel with Petra, the latitude of Petra, basically. And that's when the two prophets die, and that stops the advancing army of Muslims. They start to celebrate the death of the two prophets because in their mind and teachings that they have to be tortured to a certain level to be able to be found worthy for 52 of their members of their family to have a free ticket to heaven. So those are the ones that are giving gifts to each other because of the death of the two prophets. And then that remnant in the desert falls to their knees, prays to the Father to send the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
And 3.5 days later, that's when the two witnesses arise from the dead. They take the dead with them, the rest of the dead, up to heaven. They're the guests of the wedding. Along mm-hmm. with that remnant of living, they're the guests of the wedding. Then the remnant that's hidden from in safety in the wilderness, which is the first taking away. People miss the first taking away.
Mm-hmm.
This is not to heaven as far as the first thing. There, you're going to the wilderness, and it's a remnant. That's the bride and the wise bridesmaid, not the foolish bridesmaid. The foolish doesn't make it.
Mm-hmm.
So first, the guests at the wedding are entering because we're brought up on the second, you won't call it a rapture, the second taking away. We're brought mm-hmm. up to meet Yeshua. On the first one, Yeshua comes down to meet us.
Right.
The remnant, at least I'm hoping to be there. Okay? Because the scariest thing, it says he does the choosing.
Right, exactly.
People don't like to hear that.
Right.
Certain people that tries to go ahead, they're going into Jordan and Mr. Amon Jordan, some of them have even called me to join them. I said, well, what are you doing there? You know, oh, we're planning to go to Petra when the time comes. I said, oh, okay. So you're no longer allowing Yeshua to do the choosing. You're trying to circumvent his choosing.
Right.
I said, that's being arrogant. I said, he doesn't want arrogant people. He clearly tells you to meet him at Mount Zion in Jerusalem. And so we're waiting above ground where everyone else is going below ground. And this is going to be the scariest moment in all of Earth's history.
Right.
Are you able to stand your ground?
Mm.
Some won't, some will.
Right. Yeah.
But anybody that doesn't belong there is going to be scared out their wits and leave, because he'll add additional levels of scaredness in their own mind, where he scares them out of it. It's only going to be his chosen.
Well, yeah. Luke 21.
Pray.
Exactly. Yeah, I was just going to say, Luke 21:26 says, pray that you're accounted worthy to escape such things, right?
The rapture is the only qualifier is you believe in the Father and the Son, period. That's the guest of the wedding. But to be the bride or the bridemaid, you have to have further knowledge. You have to be part of the ones who are following, because you're the teachers in the end over the nations.
Right.
That's what the word Elohim is misinterpreted so many times in so many Bibles. The ancient word did not mean G-O-D.
No.
G-O-D is a pagan word. It didn't even mean Lord. That was also a pagan word. The actual meaning of the word means mighty one. Okay. And there's multiple mighty ones in the Bible. King David was a mighty one. Your high priests were. It says if we make it and we're part of the chosen, they're called mighty ones. Elohim or Elohai. It only means that you're a person of authority. You're a supervisor. That's what it means. It doesn't take any way from the title of God. It says his name. It says that he is a mighty one. Then you look at the description on what it's the description that defines him as a God, if you wish to. But says, you know, he's not, he has no likeness of a man. He's seven spirits. He's all knowing and everything. You look at the description that defines the name. There's only one that has that misdescription. The Mr. Messiah said over and over, says, why do you call me good? I'm not good. Only the Father's good.
Right.
I don't know the day or the hour unless the Father tells me. He can't tell time. He says all of my power comes from the Father.
Right.
As it will with you. If you're chosen and do the righteous thing, God will bless you with power like he did the prophets, you know?
Right. Right. So,
but it's lost in translation. There's an ancient saying, false knowledge is more dangerous than ignorance. Be careful of the false knowledge.
Yeah.
Many of our churches and many of our publishers are controlled by the secret societies, or they're knocking rings, as a friend of mine used to say.
Right. Right.
They are controlling the text. Be careful of that. Dig deeper. Go to the original as often as you can. I use the Leningrad because astronomy-wise, it's the one that had the patriarch ages correct, because man can't tamper with the astronomy. It's in the sky. The designation of where the planets are, there's an orbital path and the time for all these. And you're dealing with multiple planets. You can view seven objects from the Earth: the Sun, the Moon, Venus, Mercury, Saturn, and Jupiter, and so on. That's seven. When you add that to it, it's just like a watch with you go with the hours and seconds and minutes and so on. You're looking at something like almost with the constellations, another almost like 12 hands. If you do with all of the parameters of astronomy as. It's that accurate. My artifacts that I'm giving you, they show the time frame within 2 hours, two to 3 hours of the actual event.
And just to remind people, you can find Gil's work on planet7x.net. And yep. there's a ton of information there. And so
all free for everybody.
Yeah. And Gil has been kind of persecuted here throughout the years. He's been delegitimized or whatever word you want to call in the tech world, because we have all these algorithms that seem to want to eliminate any of these kind of truths and stuff. So I just encourage people to go there.
Whenever you're looking for that site, you may have to try four or five times before the algorithm sees that you're not going to be giving up, and it'll open up for you. Mm-hmm. If you do get it, pass it on to other people. It's free. USB or the links or anything. Pass this information, because it's critical for people to have the knowledge.
Right.
Because each person needs to be a watchman. They may censor me, and when it actually comes, I won't be able to tell you that it's mm-hmm. okay. This is a legitimate sighting right here. It's right where it's right on the, it has to be on the ecliptic, that line. And it has to line up with a March, April event. Mm-hmm. That's where all the past events, whenever you calculate when the crossing of Earth, remember, like, the disk of Nineveh was 40 days earlier. It shows us where it was at 40 days. Okay. Mm-hmm. But to know when it crossed, you got to add 40 days to it. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's the same Hebrew year. Okay.
Right.
Not the Hebrew year, the Gregorian calendar. It's the same year as the Gregorian calendar, because they started off in January. But, each particular item, you have to know where it is in its orbit to know how many days to add to find out when the crossing was. I'm showing you the data, what the object, the artifact is giving you. And remember, anything past Hezekiah's time, you literally had a 360-day year. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's where all calendars globally change. Within the next 5 to 10 years, people were changing because they could, because they were... they were off on their seasons and growing.
Right.
And that was critical.
Right. So, two other quick questions here. We've got about 6-7 minutes left, Gil. Time always flies, it seems like. We had an eclipse here that crossed the Earth a few years ago or a year ago that hit all the Salems. We have another one coming in 2023 and another one in 2024. Which are about 6 months apart, October to April. And it almost looks like that's presenting an Aleph Tav over North America. Do you think that has any significance towards an understanding of the beginning or the end, or the beginning of the end for North America?
Well, nothing's an accident. Remember, in the Bible, there is no such Hebrew word that means accident.
Right.
And what its purpose is, we can... Daniel could tell us, but Daniel is not here. He was an astronomer. He could tell you. That knowledge of Daniel seems to be lost slightly. So we're left to guess, pretty much. No matter how confident a person is, we're still guessing.
Mm-hmm.
Because unless someone heard his voice and he answers us for that, then that would be different, you know. But there's some people that fake the voice as well. So that's you have to be careful with them. I have a friend of mine. He keeps on saying God put it, you know, is talking to him. You know, as often as he says that, I had to tell him, I said, you know, he's talking to you more than Moses. You know? because people mix up their heart with actual, you literally hear his voice when he's speaking to you.
Right, right.
So, okay. The heart can mislead people. If exactly. I had the answer to that, I would perfectly tell you, yes, it lines up with this, but as far as I know, we're guessing right now.
Exactly. Okay. So 2 Peter 3:3, it talks about scoffers in the last days. And so, Gil, you've kind of been at this a while. I don't know exactly when you started, but are you finding that, you know, what you're presenting here is a very ominous warning, you know? is there more interest now than when you started, or is it kind of decreased in time? Or
I've seen that the interest in this data comes as more difficulty hits people, whether it's inflation or circumstances, you're going to see a peak in the Bible interest. And that will end up leading to what is the fiery dragon and how is the end times. Remember, fiery hail in the Bible is actually a meteor storm. So that's another term you have to be watched. That's two meteor storms, 150 days apart, which is caused by this one object. It has its ups and its downs, but lately it's elevated because we're seeing some crazy things globally. We're on the verge of World War III that probably will go nuclear if it doesn't calm down.
Right.
And that's CO4. One quarter of the world population dies of the plagues of this
island. Right.
A plague, and remember, this is an ancient text. A plague doesn't have to be a virus.
Right.
It could be a plague over the food. It could be a plague over technology, like if it's an EMP in your fridge ain't working and everything in your car isn't working or whatever. It's a plague to the community. People are dying from it.
Yeah.
Anything that will impact your food source, the animals, as well as human, can be considered a plague in a biblical sense.
Right.
So keep it within the knowledge of the Bible on what it meant.
And we're watching a lot of these events, which would appear to be because of this throughout history in scripture. You talk about all the famines, they're either 7 or 10 year famines, and we're watching rivers in Europe. The United States is 3/4 in a drought. I mean, we're watching a lot of events taking place now, volcanoes going off, earthquakes just triggering all over the place. And all of this is being brought on by this comet coming, isn't it?
Yes, it is. A common number is 7-year droughts. 7-year droughts are mentioned multiple times in the Bible. Like for the time of Saul and David, when they were doing their battle between each other. Saul had 3.5. David had 3.5. The total is 7. It's mentioned multiple times. The only time that was different was like Ruth. That was 10 years. And I'm sure the one for the Exodus was even longer for the Exodus. We had the time of Joseph. That was 7 years. It comes mid of the drought. If it's 10 or 7, it's mid of the drought is when it's passing. Okay, so normal for us would be 7 years. You should have 3.5 years of extreme weather change. Extreme, like what we've seen in the West. Looks like we've had at least 2, possibly 3 years. It's hard to tell. Because there's nobody holding a flag saying it started. Because it's a global event.
It is. And so.
And the great tribulation of the other three is even much more severe. It's the most severe part of the 7-year drought.
Right. Well, Gill, I hate to put a stop to it, but our time is up. So I want to thank you so much for joining me here today on Bridging the Gap. And I just want to remind everyone to remember to live up to whatever truth you have attained. And we'll see you again next time on Bridging the Gap.
There's a man going round taking names, and he decides who to free and who to blame. Everybody.
We are richly blessed to bring you what we believe is the fullest, most diverse, yet up-to-date progressive teachings, discussion, and prayer programming you can find anywhere on this planet. Be sure to take the tour of the messianiclamradio.com website. I'm Susan Hoogie, thanking you for joining us on the Messianic Lamb Video Network.